Good morning. I can't improve on that 11-year-old saying, you either pay the hospital or you pay the farmer. And I'm here to make a pitch for paying the farmer. 50 years ago, when I was a medical student in Boston, we were in the midst of the cardiovascular disease epidemic. I learned to do a history exam and do the physical examination, order the laboratory studies and all the rest of it on acute myocardial infarction victims as young as 30. Some of you may remember that. Some of you may have lost parents prematurely to that cardiovascular disease epidemic. At that time, much of the fat in the American diet was still not directly linked to coronary heart disease. A little bit down the road from where I was studying medicine was the first major longitudinal analysis of the relationship between how we lived, how we ate, what we smoked, and whether or not we got chronic disease. It was called the Framingham Study. And gradually we began to appreciate that the amount of high-density lipoprotein in our bloodstream causing stroke, acute myocardial infarction, and shortening our lives was coming largely from the saturated fat in the meat that we were eating. Most of that meat, however, was still being raised on family farms. And it was our inappropriate valuing of highly marbled steaks and other high-fat content meat that was the problem, not the way the animals were being raised. Now, today, we have a problem of public health impact on the way in which our high meat diet drives the food production system. I'm going to briefly talk about everything from the molecular level to the global level in the next 10 minutes. At the molecular level, we have these hidden ingredients. We have arsenic coming through feather meal. I bet a lot of you don't know about feather meal. 600 million kilograms. That's about 1.3 billion pounds of feathers every year are stripped away from the chickens and the turkeys that we eat. They're hydrolyzed, they're pressed to get rid of remaining fat, they're chopped up, and they are fed back to our pigs, to our cows, to our chickens. Some is used as organic fertilizer, some is used as a biodiesel ingredient, but most of it gets recycled. In the center of this graphic is the arsenic that gets recycled. At the bottom are the antibiotics that you've heard about. They go into the birds we eat, but then when the feathers are recovered, the arsenic, now in its highly toxic inorganic form, class one carcinogen, is fed back into the food system and bioaccumulates in the very birds that have shed those feathers, the next generation. And it ends up in the grocery store and our dinner plates. The antibiotic resistance story has already been laid out in great detail. But just a reminder, we have about 3.3 million kilograms that are used to treat disease in the human population, an increasing amount of that disease, of course, coming from eating the contaminated meat products that are being raised under conditions that produce the antibiotic resistance. The rest of our diet, this is a little primer on nutrition. Most of you probably know that for every gram of vegetable, there are 4 kilocalories of energy. And if you're watching your diet and you're trying to stay within that 2,000 calories a day range, you know that the more vegetables you eat, the more protein you eat, and the less fat you eat, the easier it is to stay within that caloric limitation. Much of the fat that we consume today is accompanying the 65% of dietary protein that the average American derives from eating animals or animal products. 65%. Globally, the average is about 30%. And there are very healthy people within our own society, vegetarians, vegans, Seventh-day Adventists, who derive 100% of their protein from grains, fruits, and vegetables. Now, the next impact is on farm families, their neighbors, and rural communities. This video was shot in Duplin County a year and a half ago by one of my colleagues at the Center for a Livable Future for a film that he produced with the Maryland Institute College of Art. This is liquid feces and urine being sprayed over crop fields. But if the wind is wrong in Duplin County, there are farm families and their neighbors that get liquid waste sprayed on the front of their house and on their automobile parked in their driveway. It is disgusting. We also have a real problem with the relationship between the concentration of this waste from these CAFOs. No longer is that animal waste being used as natural manure to restore nitrogen to the pasture land. People who are growing pasture-raised animals are doing the right thing. We should support them. When you concentrate all the animals in these barns, their waste stays concentrated. We, 310 million Americans, produce 7 million dry tons of waste ourselves every year. 4 million pounds of that, or 4 million tons of that, is returned to the soil after it has been treated in treatment plants. Animal waste, 40 times more than human waste, and none of it's treated. And that's what goes into these big open cesspits, euphemistically called lagoons, or it gets trucked out from the turkey or the poultry plant, poultry growers, and spread on fields, often in abundance above the ability of the plants to take it up and use all the nutrients. Finally, we have a global responsibility to do our part in feeding the world. The late Norman Borlaug, who won the Nobel Peace Prize in 1970 for his work on developing high-yield wheat varieties in Mexico that then led to the Green Revolution in Latin America and Asia, he was asked by the Union of Concerned Scientists around 1996 to look forward. What would we be able to do when the world's population reached 8 billion people by 2025. He said, well, if we could get everybody eating mostly fruits, vegetables, and grains, we could feed 9.5 to 10 billion people. In other words, we'd have a safety margin of 1.5 billion extra mouths that could be fed. However, if we continue the export of our high-meat North American diet, as we're now sadly seeing among urban elites, even in the lowest income countries around the world, we would only be able to feed about 3.5 to 4 billion people. So when you eat right, when you support the farmer who is raising beef on grain the way Fred Kirschenman does, the way Terry Spence does with his cow-calf operation in Missouri, we are contributing to eating higher quality food in smaller proportions and paying the farmer instead of the hospital and making more available for people around the world. A healthy, high vegetable, fruit, and grain diet is our global citizenship responsibility. And then finally, each of us has the opportunity to learn more about the food system, as we're doing today, to engage, not just engage our friends and neighbors, our politicians, to lobby, to advocate, but engage internally, change our own behavior, and then reform the food system together. The left-hand picture is a farmer's market in Highlandtown, Baltimore. We at the Center for a Livable Future are engaging our neighbors, we're supporting our local farmers, we're educating people about the benefits of maybe paying a little bit more and getting a much higher quality of food, a much healthier kind of food, and being connected with the people who are growing that food for us. The center represents volunteers at an organic farm in Lincoln, Massachusetts. We can go out. I'm proud to say that in September, my wife and I helped harvest in a gleaning project for the United Way of Central Maryland over 800 pounds of potatoes per person, and there were 35 of us out there. And we did this in about a four-hour period. It was fabulous, made me feel good. The potatoes were used to help food pantries throughout that part of the state. There are a lot of things we can do, even as busy as we are. And finally, on the right, is a community meeting, also in the city of Baltimore, to go over the details of a food availability assessment that had been conducted by our Eating for the Future program at the center. As you can see from the photo, this is a typical mixed population of inner city people who are thinking carefully about what comes next as they try to raise their families in a healthy way. So if we are going to engage, personal engagement, we have to eat 21 times a week. In the year 2000, the then Surgeon General said in Healthy People 2010, one of the goals for the nation by 2010 was to reduce the content of our saturated fat by 15%. Now, how many of you in the audience could 21 times a week look at your plate and say, I'm going to leave this because that's about 15% of the saturated fat on the plate? None of us could do that, not even a trained nutritionist. But one day a week is 15% of the week. So the Meatless Monday campaign here in New York worked with us. We provided some of the scientific input and fact-checking and so forth. And this now has gone viral. It's not just all across North America, it's around the world. And you can participate. CSAs. This is a great way to support local farming communities that are trying to do the right thing by growing healthy food in a sustainable way. Slow food, USDA, certified organic, all of these things are should be uppermost in your mind when you are on the demand side of the equation, buying from the food system. If enough of us on the demand side influence through our choices, we will transform the food system and the supply side will follow. Thank you very much. Thank you.